Hello everyone and welcome to my channel. In this video we're gonna be making a super easy grid-based building system in Unity. I used this system in my isometric game Lost in Athilidus. I have a Devlog series about this game where I briefly described how this works, but now we will dive more into specifics. Also, subscribe to my channel to see more tutorials and Devlogs. First of all, let's look at how the system works. We have two tile maps in our game, one for real placement and one for indication where the building is now. Our building has a predetermined size, like 3x3 or 2x4, etc. When we instantiate a building, the area under it will be painted with colored tiles on the temporary tile map. As we move the building, this area will follow it. If we can place at this spot, the area will be painted green, and if not, red. The logic for this is simple, we just check if our main tile map has white tiles at the same position that is about to be painted. Let's start with setting up our project. You can download a starting package and skip to the coding part right away. Link is in the description. Also, the full code that we will write in this tutorial is going to be available to download too, but if you plan to just copy and paste it, I highly recommend you to watch the explanation part of the video and the part on how to make the system better. Create a 2D project in Unity. In the scene, create an isometric tile map. This tutorial will work for a regular grid as well, but since I worked on an isometric game, we will look at it. I am setting the size of the grid to 2, 1, 1, and cell gap to 0.2, 0.1, 0. Again, this is optional. The next step is important. Duplicate the tile map object. One of them will be our temporary tile map for indication, and the other will be our main tile map. Create a new sorting layer and call it background. Drag it about the default layer. We need this because the tiles should be underneath everything else. Set the sorting order to 0 on the main tile map and 1 on the temp. They both should be on the background sorting layer. I forgot to do it now, but I corrected it later. Create a button or more for instantiating a new building. In the game, we would probably have a shop with buildings, but to keep things simple, I will just make a button. At the end of the video, I will explain how to make the system work with a shop. We will also need a prefab of a house to place. Watch closely, because it has a little twist to it. Create a new game object by dragging a house sprite into the hierarchy. Rename it to Sprite. Create an empty game object, rename it to House Prefab. Then drag the sprite object onto this empty object. This is necessary for an offset. We'll see later in the video. Finally, make it a prefab. Another thing that we need is three types of tiles. White tile to indicate the available territory, green to indicate a house area or a possible house area, and red, where a house cannot be placed. Now we are all set up and it's time to code. Create two scripts. Yes, it is that simple. I named them grid building system and building. Add the grid building system script to the grid object, the one with the tile maps as children. Add building script to the house prefab. Let's open up them in the script editor. Grid building system is going to implement a single tone pattern, so we need to create a reference to it. Then I create three regions to keep my code clean. One for Unity methods. These we already know. We will need a wake method, start and update. We can create them now. Tile map management. These will be used to get and set tiles on our tile maps. Building placement. These methods are responsible for building placement. Now let's go to the building script. We will need a region for all the placement methods. Next, create references to grid layout and the tile maps. Initialize them in the editor. In the awake method, initialize the current field with this. After the declaration of this class, I'm going to create an enum with tile types. Empty, white, green, red. Create a public static dictionary to store different tiles. we're going to initialize it in the start method using resources. We will use this dictionary to easily access all the tiles when we need to compare them or set them on the grid. Before diving into placement, we need to create a few helper methods in our tile map management region. Here is the code to them. There are multiple reasons for these additional methods. First and obvious being to avoid access code. But the other one is that Unity's method getTilesBlock makes the whole editor crash. I discovered it when I was making my game Leo. It turns out that I was not the only one who had the same issue. I wrote my own method, which gets tiles one by one and returns an array of them. Go back to our building script and create two public fields, a bool placed. Note that I made a private set for it, so it can be changed outside this class. And a bounce int area. This is the size of the area under the building. Initialize it in the editor. For example, my house will take up a 2x2 area, so I wrote 2, 2 and 1. It is important to write 1 on the Z and not leave it 0, because of the way that our tile arrays are functioning. Remember this fillTiles method? It creates an array based on the size of an area. It multiplies all the values of bounds int area. If one of them is 0, we will have no tiles in the array. Switch back to our grid building system. We will create a reference to the building we are placing right now. I called it temp, since it's going to be changed every time when we get a new building. We will also need a vector 3 to save the previous position of the building. Now create a public method called initializeWithBuilding, which accepts a game object as a parameter. It is responsible for instantiation of a new building. We will now go to the editor and attach this method to our button. As a game object, set our house prefab. Go to the update method in our grid building system. We will write a simple movement. It is not the movement I'd recommend to use. In my game, I went for a smooth drag, which I will overview at the end of this video. For now, we will keep things simple. If we don't have a building, we do nothing. If we detect a press, we will check if it wasn't on the UI. Then we will check if our building is not placed. If it passes these conditions, we get the position of the mouse and also convert it to world point. Then we get the cell position on our grid, and if it doesn't match the previous position, we can perform some movement. The reason I did this check is if the positions are the same, I didn't want to color the grid each time. It only happens when the new position is different. After checking, we set the building position to the new one and add an offset to make the building sprite snap to the center of a grid cell. And we reset the previous position. Now we can move the building in the game. The next step is to make the area underneath the house visible. Firstly, we create a method which sets the previous area that our house was standing on to empty. Secondly, we will write a method called followBuilding. We save our building area in a variable. And now we're going to use one of our additional methods. We get an array of tiles from our main tile map. This will help us detect if the placement is possible here, and if it is not, we will highlight the area red. Create an array of 4 tiles. In a loop, we go through each tile from the main tile map and check if it is white, which means the placement is possible here. If we detect any other tile type, we break the loop and fill the array with red tiles. After that, we set the tiles on the temporary tile map and reassign the previous area. We call this method in two places. When we initialize our building system with a building, and when we move the house. And now we can go back to Unity and paint some white tiles on the grid. This is necessary because white tiles mean points where we can place a building, and our following works based on this rule. At this point, we can see if we adjusted our prefab sprite right. If the house is below the area or above, go to our prefab and adjust the sprite position. The only thing left is to make it possible to place the building. In the grid building system, we will create a method called canTakeArea, which accepts area as a parameter. Inside of it, we will get an array of tiles from the main tile map and check each of them. If they are not all white, we return false because we can't place here. If they are all white, we return true. In our building script, we will create a method canBePlaced. Here, we will initialize our area to pass it to the grid building system. This method will also return true if the placement is possible. Next, in the grid building system, create a simple method, takeArea. Inside of it, we will do two actions. Set the tiles on the temporary tile map to empty and set the tiles on the main tile map to green. In the building script, create a method place. It is really similar to our canBePlaced method, except this time we set the bool placed to true and call the grid building system to take the area. To make these methods work, go to the update method in the grid building system and write an else if statement right after we check the mouse press. I use a space button to place. Check if the building can be placed, and if yes, place it. And now we're just going to create one simple if statement to cancel the building placement if escape button is pressed. This is it! A simple grid-based building system is done. We can instantiate a building, move it around, and place. Now, we're going to take a look at how to put this system into a real game and make it more advanced. In a game that has a building mechanic, we would probably get houses from a shop. To make this system communicate with a shop, we will need an event manager and an event for house purchase. The shop will invoke this event and the building system will listen to it. The event can pass a prefab of a building to the grid building system. Call the initialization method and pass this prefab to it. Another thing that you would probably want to do in your game is the editing mode. The way I did it in my game is that I created a button that will enable the grid object. In the tutorial it is always enabled. Then we can detect a press on a building, pass a prefab to our system and disable the original building. This way it will stay at the same place if we decide to cancel its placement. And if the building is placed on a new spot, we will destroy the original and clear the area on the main tile map. And one last enhancement for our system is the smooth building movement. When I started developing my simulation game, I made a grid-based movement similar to what I showed you in this tutorial. But the thing is, this kind of movement is not what you want to see in a real game. Later on, I changed the movement in my game to drag. For this, we need to add a collider to our house. Don't forget to offset it to the same position as the sprite. And implement three methods in our building script. OnMouseDown is where it saves an offset from the center of the house to the clicked position on it. OnMouseDrag is where it moves the building to where the mouse is. OnMouseUp is where the building snaps to the nearest grid position. And this is it for this tutorial. Thank you for watching. If you have any suggestions for what I should make next, leave them in the comments. Also, check out my Devlog series about the development of my simulation game called Lost in Athilidus. You can find a lot of useful resources and explanations there. Be sure to subscribe to my channel to see more tutorials in the future. Bye!